it gets all those different assistance muscles that we're lazy and don't use anymore, to where you have to stabilize the weight with your body weight, and makes it harder. I think that's another reason why a lot of the guys now rely too much on the machines. Now, don't get me wrong, I love machines, because me having to work around injuries from when I got a strength base when I was younger, they helped me maintain and add a bit more size with the density I added having that strength base. But if I don't have any injuries on my back, I've never torn my lat, I've never torn my bicep, there's no reason why I can't really push myself in that area. And I've never heard of somebody saying your back is way too developed. You need to not be a bodybuilder. Every show I've seen, is back and legs are a huge contributor to why somebody wins. The nervous system warm up. We're on the chest supported row. Start adding a plate each set. Plates, four plates, five plates, six plates, work up to seven. And have somebody just peel the weight and do what you call shock principle, strip set. Strip the weight. You don't see a lot of guys doing that stuff anymore, where they're doing giant sets and super sets and stuff like that, which is kind of like how the guys used to train, which I think is another reason why the guys look, not to call them out or anything, but a little bit more watery and soft now. They don't have the same detail in the muscle, which is what's missing, I think. I'm going to try and bring some of that back.
I know these are training techniques, but do you actually like training this way?
Yeah, I do. It's just old school, you know, and most people were like, God, you're such a fucking crony. But I've just always been that way. Like, a client gave me a smartphone, and I'm like, what do you want me to do? Look at porn with this? Like, I write everything down on a dry erase board, clients. I don't need to count my fucking steps. The stair climber can do that for me. So then my dad's like, can I keep it? I'm like, yeah, it's a $400 thing or whatever, but I don't fucking use it. Whatever. Fuck. Fuck around. Chest supported row, I really like this one. I've gotten older. And I've always been such an old school crony. Like, I really like the prison T-bar rows. I've learned how to pick my battles to keep my body to hold up. It's okay to use machines now, man, and be more careful and focus more on the muscle intention and work the muscle from the inside and out. Focus on getting the full range of motion, squeeze, stretch, contract, visualization. And you can still build. Like today, we'll do dumbbell rows. Yeah, I can sling those 250s and row them. You've seen me row them with Ben, but I stick with the 200s. Focus on each side, keeping that foot forward like Nick Walker does them, and squeeze. Even though he's a lot younger than me, he brought up an interesting point. It's not about how much weight you lift, it's about how hard you can contract the muscle when you lift it. And it's very true. A goal I would use for this one is I'd work up to 8 plates when I was bulked up. And then now that I'm going for more conditioning and quality in the muscle, I'll keep it around 7 and focus on the mind-muscle connection. Try and get 6 good quality reps. Full range of motion, contract. No half-rep shit. Then what I'll do, have them pull 2 plates off, and I'll rep 5 plates, then 4 plates, and 3 plates, so like a 4 drop set. And you get all those reps in a row, because you gotta think that 6, 16, 26, 36 reps in a row. That's a lot of reps. It would be called Arnold and Joe Weider used to call it the shock principle, where you strip the weight. Like Arnold said in that one bodybuilding.com video, you got a guy that always does the same exercise. Say he starts off his chest routine always with incline flies. Well, let's do something to shock the body. Let's start off with 315, on bench press and go 15 reps. Then you pull the plate off and do 225, do as many reps as you can. And then pull another plate off and do 135, do as many reps as you can. Now you've shocked the muscle because you've taken it out of its comfort zone. You always started with incline flies. Now you started off with bench press, but you use the shock principle by stripping the weight. Some dumbbell rows, but more through muscle intention. I saw Nick Walker do him like this. He's one of my new favorite guys. A lot of people judge because of how big and massive he is, you know, and young. But kid's doing something right. I'm really impressed with him and Hunter Labrada. And I'm sure Hunter, a lot of it is Lee Labrada. But these younger, new generation guys, those are the two of my favorites to watch, even though I'm an old fart. I still get inspired by the new blood. Helps me help my my dick keep spinning like your favorite CD, baby.
Am I on your way, Nick?
Not at all.
We're talking about probably naming the video this, but muscle intention is focusing and targeting the muscle that you're working. When you're doing a dumbbell row, you're lengthening your lats and stretching it on each side, getting that full range of motion and coming up and squeezing. When you put your foot back, you can use more momentum and rock. There, I can row a 250 pound dumbbell, but I use the body language. We had to use a 200, but I put the foot forward. You can see how I have to isolate everything on my right side and row it back. I don't have the distance. I put my leg back to where I can kind of scoot back here. So it makes everything isolate the lat more, which causes the muscle intention. Movement intention is different. That's powerlifting. Just because somebody can squat 800 pounds, it doesn't mean their legs are gonna look like a bodybuilder. That's getting the weight from point A to point B. This is building muscle, which involves muscle intention and hypertrophy. Swing, you have to pull it with your back.
Is that muscle intention? Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah. Big time. Look. Arm row with cables. So you're just isolating. We already did two really hard movements, the chest supported row, super heavy with a shock principle, then dumbbell rows, but alternating each side. Putting the foot forward to make you isolate the lat more. Those take a lot out of you, so now we're doing more detail work. using the seated rope, just alternating each side, working our way up the stack, maybe 5-6 sets. When I first started competing, I knew the lats, it was weird, I did different things. I thought outside the box, I did actually what you call pendulay rows, where you set the weight down and bent over row it, and got my back bigger. But one thing I really had to work extra hard on, it took till I got in my 30s to get muscle maturity and taking time off and coming back and going to the heavyweight class. But I always would like to start off a lot of times with bent over rows or dumbbell rows, to where I can go extremely heavy and push myself. Pull downs or chin ups, you know, I throw like second or third. Sometimes I always start off like last back workout, I actually started off with them first. I worked up to 300 pounds on the stack, then went to dumbbell rows. But like today, I started off with chest supported rows. Sometimes I'll even alternate prison T-bar rows. Foundation, even when you're 12, kid that age, start exercising sit-ups, crunches, push-ups, you know, chin-ups are good, and that's why I did them last at the end of the workout. And the challenge, we did like sets of five, but just weighted, and I tried to get full range of motion all the way down, all the way up. The reason I throw the chin-ups on is because I'm used to carrying a heavier body weight. Right now I'm walking around at about 235 body weight, and granted this is no clothes, like they used to weigh me as an amateur before I turned pro. But you know, with this chains added, it probably puts me at about 260. That's 260, I think, was when y'all first felt me do legs. That first workout, you hadn't seen me in a while. I've even been as heavy as 270. Probably the healthiest I feel when I'm off season is about 245, which puts me striking distance, 15 to 20 pounds from contest weight. And that is probably where I'd like to stay for the rest of my bodybuilding career, so I can last, because the skin movement of gaining and dropping, I'm already at a phase to where if I can add a few pounds of quality muscle gain a year, I can make it look even better with the muscle maturity, instead of making these 8-pound jumps, which are great, but think about all that skin movement of gaining and dropping. And I'm not trying to call the kettle black or send the devil in to do God's work, but as of late, we've had a lot of older bodybuilders passing away. And I think a lot of that has to do with us figuring out that we lost track of when Jim Mannion created the NPC, what it was all about. If you look at Lee Haney's body, he was the first ever Nationals champion in 1982. And when he won Mr. Olympia, he could always pull his stomach in, he was healthy looking, and it was all about a celebration of the human body and being healthy and being fit and being able to glow when you go out there. Yeah, it's cool to be freaky and look like all that, but you still got to remember where it all started. So I think that me thinking in that direction, instead of trying to reinvent the wheel, go back to the way it worked in the beginning, and that formula seemed to work for a while. Now, I mean, everybody wants to be the best, but what good is being the best if it brings out the worst?